This episode of the Disney Nerds Podcast is brought to you by TouringPlans.com. Spend less time in line and more time riding your favorite attractions. TouringPlans.com.
Welcome to the splendor, the spectacle, the sparkling sensation, where the romance, the comedy, and the thrill of Disney fantasies come to electric life.
And as our friend Jiminy said, welcome. Welcome to the Disney Nerds Podcast, a place each week where like-minded people get together to discuss all things Disney. We'll help you get your Disney fix on. Here we go.
The Magic Kingdom proudly presents, in a million points of musical light, the Magic Worlds of Disney.
Hello and welcome to show number 284 of the Disney Nerds Podcast. Hey guys, how's it going? And welcome back to the show. On this week's show, we've got a lot of things to cover. We've got news from the parks, we've got some updates from Morgan's trip, and we're going to be finishing up our final rounds of the Disney Dining Madness tournament. But before we get to any of that, let's see who's on the show with us this week. Hey Sam, how's it going?
I'm back. I got out of a blizzard in Denver. I don't know how I did that, but I got out of a blizzard in Denver, flew to Chicago to get back home. And when I'm in Chicago, I see all these people in their Star Wars gear. And, well, it's celebration. We'll get to that later. Anyway, glad to be back.
Very good. Glad to have you back. And we have Morgan with us tonight. Hey, Morgan, how's it going?
Hey, guys. How's it going? Well, I didn't fight a blizzard, but, man, I'm fighting that Disney depression right now.
Oh, you're fresh back, aren't you?
I'm fresh back.
Yeah.
Well, that's all right. I'm sure you've got a couple trips in the works. That always helps.
Of course.
Oh, very cool. Before we start tonight, what I want to do is touch base on the blog. Jimmy talked about it last week, and I tell you what, we've had another great week of some good articles. Morgan, tell us what we've been talking about out there.
All right. Well, over at the DisneyNerdsPodcast.com, our blog, we've actually got, it seems like a lot of news is coming out lately. The biggest piece of news, which we actually have two separate posts on, we have gotten the Illuminations end dates announced. We know when we are all going to be crying because Illuminations is going away.
And that was my initial reaction until...
But, exactly.
Yeah, and that's the thing. I feel like we're going to have a love-hate relationship right now. We're gonna hate that Illuminations is leaving, but in another post we've got new Epcot Forever show, which this is a show that's going to take place of Illuminations, and man, does this thing look awesome.
We heard about it, and now we finally got to see a little bit about it in a video that Disney Parks blog shared, and it looks great.
Oh, no doubt.
I feel like we will cry at the passing of Illuminations, but then they're going to just cheer us right back up with Epcot Forever.
So I Illuminations ending, it's been there so long. We're talking over 20 years for the same nighttime thing. And unless there was something special like a holiday tag or an event, to me, it almost became background noise there recently. It wasn't something that I stop and watch all the time, even though I love it and I will watch it from a distance. But it's not something we ever like camped out to see until, of course, the last day comes around. But along those lines, I am looking forward to Epcot Forever. I'm looking forward to this new show. It looks like there's some kind of drone thing going on in there. And this is just a temporary thing until we get the real show. I am excited for Epcot Forever.
Oh, I know. I can't wait for this one. And I tell you what, we had a post with the video there, too, Sam mentioned. Definitely worth checking out. What else were we talking about this week?
And then another thing that we're talking about, which Sam already touched base on, is the Star Wars Celebration over in Chicago, which I believe, Sam, you kind of geeked out there a little bit on us.
Star Wars Celebration is really cool. I wish I could be there. I actually couldn't get a ticket, which is why I'm not there. But I am going to be watching it from home, which I hope that you guys are watching, because it's probably going on right now while you're downloading and listening to this. Otherwise, there's some replays out there. But Celebration Chicago, we're going to see the trailer. By the time you're listening to this, you have seen the trailer for Episode 9. Cannot wait to see that. They're talking about the Mandalorian. They're talking about Vader Immortal. 20 years of Star Wars Legos. I want to go to that panel. Come on.
You're not excited about it at all. I can tell, Star Wars Legos.
Every time one of these openings comes out, every time there's more news, every time we hear about a new land, you just turn into a kid again. It's great.
That's the way I look at it. And, of course, Disney Parks Blog is going to be streaming the Galaxy's Edge panel, which will also be streamed at StarWars.com and the Star Wars official YouTube channel, which is YouTube.com/StarWars, which, by the way, these guys do it right when I compare it to D23. And here's what I mean. They're live the entire conference. They get people and interview them. They'll bring up, Mark Hamill will be on there. They'll bring Daisy Ridder up, and they'll bring up all of these people and just interview them about what's happening. And that's just cool to me to see.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, definitely. It's great if you can't get those elusive tickets and you want to hear, as it's happening, the news, what the actors are doing, everything. Yeah.
One of the panels, there's lots of panels happening, right? In fact, you can go download the app, which is what I've been doing, is going through the app like I'm there and looking at where things are and what panels are going up, trying to decide what I would go to, because it's like D23. There's three things at once. Which one do you think's better than the other? And that's hard to pick. But one of the panels that Disney, that will be streamed live at StarWars.com, is Dave Filoni, who was the lead for their animated series, Rebels specifically. There's so much we can talk about here, Ed, right? Star Wars Rebels and what they did with Rebels and the four seasons of Rebels, which ended, and then Resistance is out now, which has turned into something really cool, and they're going to be talking about season two. But Dave Filoni did not move to Resistance, and a lot of people wondered why. Well, it's because he jumped over to The Mandalorian, which is a live-action Mandalorian program based on a new Mandalorian, not Boba Fett or Jango Fett, but somebody that came after that.
At least
and
for now.
That, I'm sorry.
I said at least for now. Keep going. We'll hear about a Fett, I'm sure, down the road.
We're going to hear about it. Absolutely. So it starts there. And then what's going to happen? Start again. At least for now, yes. However, Mandalorian is one of the first Star Wars exclusive original content that's going to go over to Disney Plus. And today we heard a ton about Disney Plus.
Exactly, and we're actually working on a blog about that right now, so if you guys are listening to this, it's already up on our website. Disney Plus, I mean, how excited are we to, after we spent all this money and all the Star Wars, the Marvel, and the Disney movies over our lives, we're going to be able to stream it all for one low price.
One low monthly price, or an annual.
Or an annual price,
but
yep.
But there's so much more to Disney Plus. Of course, this is Disney's streaming service, which I'm sure you guys have heard about. And this is really Disney repositioning themselves as a direct-to-consumer content provider. And when you look at the way content is consumed these days with mobile devices and smart TVs and tablets, and it's just their move into this area. And what's most interesting about it is something else we haven't really talked about, is the acquisition of Fox and the assets that come with Fox. One of the assets that came with that was Fox's share of Hulu, which Disney already had a share of Hulu. Put those two shares together and it's 60%, which now puts them in a great position to leverage that, along with an acquisition they made about a year ago, to create the platform Disney Plus, which works like ESPN Plus to deliver to those consumers the content that they are just rich in content. It's amazing and it's awesome.
Oh, I know. I can't wait to actually digest all the information that we saw today and be able to kind of go over it in detail and figure out exactly what we're going to get, how, and when.
I can tie it back to Star Wars, because just a few days ago, it's April 11th right now, the Clone Wars animated series, all of it, which I have watched on Netflix multiple times, is no longer available on Netflix. Because guess where that's going to end up?
Of course.
In the Star Wars section of Disney Plus.
Sure.
Exactly. So, I mean, you're going to have a Star Wars section, you're going to have a Marvel section, and of course, you're going to have the Disney section. And, you know, they announced in the call that's going to be, and this is going to be on our post, November 12th. You know, sweet. That's when we're going to get Disney Plus.
It seems too far away.
It seems far, but I mean, we're almost halfway through April, so
it's going to go by before you know it. I love the way that they broke down the content, and a couple of things that they mentioned in this. We should note this was an investor relations call where Disney was essentially presenting to the investment community on why this is good for shareholders, which it is, by the way, because when you look at Disney as a company, they had an issue a few years ago with ESPN and some of the cable bundling, and they were losing some money and what was once perceived as the cash cow. ESPN Plus sort of righted that ship, and now they got more that they're pulling into this direct to consumer content. One of the cool things, as you broke it down, because it was basically Disney, Marvel, Star Wars, Pixar, and National Geographic, which is interesting. That was part of the 20th Century Fox acquisition. So what used to be Disney Nature, now just call it National Geographic, and that's fine.
Which, honestly, Disney Nature is one thing that I personally love. So now to see it basically become part of National Geographic and that just be one thing is really awesome, because you've got penguins coming out here all around Earth Day. You know, you've got I'm excited about the National Geographic aspect of it.
Well, I think it gives the Disney Wildlife movies a whole new aspect of resources, basically, just because of the nitty-gritty type documentaries that the National Geographic Channel and the organization put out. Oh, this is going to be great.
I honestly think it's a better brand for those things, because Disney Nature, you put Disney in front of it, and maybe you don't take it as seriously as a nature film, even though we know Walt's history and everything that happened there, and Ed, you've blogged about that in the past, and it's an amazing history, but I think National Geographic, you just go into that with a different mindset, so that's great.
Oh, well, sure. No, most of the time on the National Geographic documentaries and shows, you don't have a story. You don't know the names of the animals, quote-unquote, like monkeys and things like that. They basically gave them very, very caricature like parts, which actually is great, because that helps the kids and that helps people just pay attention and follow along. But you're right. Yeah. National Geographic, that's Jacques Cousteau. That's climbing to Mount Everest. That's going to the moon even. That's everything.
That's really cool. Another thing that they talked about during the analyst day was from Marvel. And now I'm way into Star Wars, Marvel not as much. But what was interesting was Captain Marvel, which is the movie in theaters right now, will be the first mainstream movie that will go straight to Disney Plus. So after they go through the theatrical release, then there's the home DVD release, and then it becomes the part of Disney Plus. That's a standard cadence, and that's going to be a cool cadence, because what you did is just invested in a streaming copy of every Disney movie that's coming out, or Pixar, or whatever. Wow.
Right.
And you know what I'm interested in seeing is sometimes with some of the streaming services, you will get you get access to this movie the same day it comes out on DVD in the stores.
Yep.
So I'm interested in seeing if Disney's going to do anything like that for any of their movies.
Now, another aspect of this, which is going to be interesting to see over the next, I guess, 5 months, 6 months, is how much cross-advertising they're going to do between the parks, resorts, and Disney Plus channel. Once Disney Plus starts, are they going to advertise parks? Are they going to have somewhat... Now, of course, they said no ads, but are they going to then pop up their informational things about Disney? And in reverse of that, are we going to start seeing now handout paper and basically signage about Disney Plus all over the parks?
And I feel like you are. I mean, if anybody that has stayed at the resorts know that there's all these Disney channels, and I feel like we are going to see little blurbs, little ads on those channels and in the parks. For Disney Plus. And honestly, one thing that I'm secretly hoping for, anyone that stayed on property, there is, I call it the Disney Nature channel, and I keep talking about Disney Nature because it's just one thing that I personally love. There's like a channel that shows nothing but all these great things that Disney as a company does for the environment, for animals, and it plays 24/7. And I honestly have that channel on every time I'm in my room. Mm-hmm. I'm secretly hoping that I'm going to be able to access that with Disney Plus.
Oh, sure. Some variation of it, maybe. I have one better, though. If you've been on a Disney cruise, one of the things that is a benefit of being in your room a little bit, maybe as you're going to sleep or whatever, waking up, is that the TV, while you can't get any TV stations from land, they have the entire library of all the Disney movies available for you to basically watch whenever you want to watch.
That's basically what we're getting here.
And that's what exactly I'm wondering now. What if they give that to you at the resort when you're staying at Walt Disney World? So you're at the resort, you're going to go to your room, you have that full library because you know what? It's the Disney company. Obviously, it's a different part of it and they have to make money on their own. However, being able to offer that to somebody while they're at the resort, that's a pretty good thing.
And along honestly, with a whole bunch of ads that say you can get this at home for this much a month.
Totally where I was going with that, yes.
Or they throw in, hey, use discount code da-da-da-da-da. And we'll give you the first month free, or we'll give you, half off free. But one thing I have noticed, and, just reminded me, most of the TVs that are going into the refurbished rooms, they're smart TVs anyway. So to give that service on those in-room TVs on property would not be that hard to do at all.
Oh, no. I mean, that's what they're made for, basically.
Yeah, so when I stay at a Marriott or any other brand hotel with one of the smart TVs, I can go right to Netflix or right to Hulu and put my username and password in and get access to my stuff.
Right. So now
great start your trial, right? I could see that, Ed. Start your trial. Sign up today. It's free while you're here.
And everything's Wi-Fi. You can do that. I can totally see the news channels actually being secondary now at the resorts in that they have to get that just for if you want to see the weather or you want to catch up on news. But otherwise, you're going to come to the room. You're going to throw on a cartoon from 1945, or you're going to throw on Herbie the Love Bug or something like that.
Or I'm just going to go watch Peter Pan because we just rode Peter Pan's flight. Perfect. And the kids asked me about it. I love it.
So there's so many opportunities. Well, let's hope Disney takes advantage of that. We're talking about the parks and the cross-advertising and things like that. One of the things Disney's been doing really well has been bringing Star Wars into the parks. And Morgan was down there this past weekend to take advantage of that. Morgan, why don't you tell us about that?
Well, if you guys did not pay attention, especially to the Instagram this weekend for the Disney Nerds podcast, there was a Run Disney Race weekend. And if you've ever been to Disney during Run Disney Race weekend, you know it's a weekend like no other. So basically what they do is depending on the theme, and last weekend it was Star Wars. Every April they do Star Wars.
Was there another like Star Wars The Dark Side, or what was it exactly?
Well, here's the thing. So if you don't follow the news of Run Disney, as this year right now, there's a lot of construction going on in Disneyland, so there are no races going on at Disneyland. So what they did previous years for these Star Wars races is at Walt Disney World, you had the dark side. And at Disneyland, you had the light side. Well, with no races being at Disneyland, there was no light side. So what they did this year is this year it was the rival run. You got to pick what side you were on. You could be light side, you could be dark side. And Sam, we know you would have picked dark side.
Absolutely.
So you pick your side, and after you've chosen, and keep in mind, backtrack here a little bit, you register for these races anywhere from 6 months to a year ahead of time. Run Disney races are super popular, so you actually pick then and there what side you were going to be on. I decided, not that it mattered for the actual race, to go light side, since I had done the dark side at Walt Disney World its inaugural year in 2016.
Did it change your medal, or is it still a rival run medal?
It is a rival run medal.
So it didn't change. Okay.
The only thing that changed is your bib, which if you're not a runner, if you don't know anything about races, the bib is basically the piece of paper that you wear on your clothing that has your number. 1, 2, 3, 4, whatever. If you were dark side on your bib, you had a dark side character. If you were light side, you had a light side character on your bib. That's right. So like I said, I chose light side just because like I said, I've already ran the dark side. I figured I'd try the light side, see if there's anything, you know, worth it.
Who was on your bib?
Finn was on my bib. So I did the 5K. And the 5K was Finn and Captain Phasma. So depending on, like I said, which one you did, determined which character was on your bib. And of course you had, if you register early, your name. So my name was on there. My race number was on there. And you picked it up at the expo. Now this is the cool thing that I personally kind of have fun with whenever I do a Run Disney race. At ESPN World of Sports, you have to go at least the day before the race, which most race weekends start. First race is Friday, second race is Saturday, third race is Sunday. So the expo usually starts on Thursday.
Which, that's the 5K, the 10K, the half mile, and the mile. Is that what it is?
Yeah. Okay. 5K, 10K, and half. Unless it's a marathon weekend, then you got four races, but that's a whole other race in January.
Yeah, forget that.
Yeah. We could talk Run Disney for a whole episode, probably.
Sure.
So you go to the expo at ESPN World of Sports. If you're staying on property, you can take a bus. If you're not staying on property, you can, of course, drive over. You have one area you go to. You pick up your bib. And there is merchandise after you've picked up your bib. And I hadn't done a race since 2016. And I tell you what, merchandise, which is what Disney does best, I think probably quadrupled since last time I did a race. Mm-hmm. So I went live and showed everybody the merchandise. It was a whole room. And I'm not talking about like a little hotel room. I am talking about a massive room of merchandise.
It looked like it could have been an indoor soccer field or something like that.
And it was the arena, which is a newer addition to World of Sports, which of course they probably host soccer games, basketball games, you know, you name it. But basically it was a sports indoor arena, and the whole ground floor of it was merchandise, and you name it, they had it merchandise. Shirts, cups, mugs, pins, headbands, hats, you name it, they slapped that merchandise, you know, rather than on it.
What's your favorite mug brand? What's that silver mug or silver cup? The metal cups?
So I am a fan of Tervis, and Tervis has started doing the stainless steel. So I purchased a Tervis stainless steel water bottle. One side had the Rival Run 2019 logo on it. The other side said, "May the course be with you."
I see what they did.
Of course. One of the things I always hear from these runs and races is that you get a really great view of the parks that you don't normally get walking around during the daytime. How was that? What did you see this time?
So one thing you've got to keep in mind.
Can I say, where did you start for the 5K?
For the 5K, the 5K is completely in Epcot.
Okay.
If you do a 10K, I believe you do Epcot in Hollywood. If you do a half marathon, they've changed the course, and I think you actually touch all four parks, if not three of them. So these races, you have to keep in mind, they're not going on during normal park hours. My race was supposed to begin at 5:30, and I'll get to the supposed to in a minute.
5:30 a.m.
A.M., not p.m., a.m.
So where were you staying? Did you have to get a bus? How'd all that work?
So I had to go cheap on this trip, so I stayed off property.
Okay.
They do want you in the parking lot an hour before the race. So that means I had to be in the Epcot parking lot by 4:30 in the morning.
Wow.
Guys, I'm not a morning person. I got to go running the night before. I was not smart, but hey, I'm at Disney. I'm on vacation. I wasn't giving up any time.
Yes, I understand.
And 5K, worst case, you could walk 5K in the time frame. So I guess keep that in mind as far as getting ready for this. So, okay, keep going.
I'm not a super runner. That's why I will do a 5K at Disney, because I don't want to have to worry about, I got to get my 8 hours of sleep to do the race right. No, I'll do a 5K and I'll walk it if I have to.
Mm-hmm.
So like I said, in the parking lot by 4:30, you then, if you've ever been to Epcot during a race weekend, you see one of the back corners pretty much is almost sectioned off. There is, they've got the finish line, the start line. They've got seats there. Are
they the same line, the finish and the start?
No, they're off a little bit for the 5K. Now, for the 10K and the half, they're in two different locations. They're in different parks. You start one place and somewhere else.
In the parking lot? Or
they're both in the parking lot for the 5K.
All right.
So you have to work your way through the parking lot, through the area. You got to go through security, of course, because even though you're in the parking lot, there's security for the race. And they have corrals where you start off at. And they have three corrals, A, B, and C. On your bib, it tells you which corral you go to. You basically hang out there till the beginning of the race. Normally, no big deal. They've got music playing. DJ Elliott is there playing music. This time it was Star Wars music. They were showing clips of the Star Wars movies. They had their announcers out there to keep everybody awake and hype. Because, hey, it's 4:30 in the morning. We all got to stay awake.
Were they themed announcers or just a couple guys in sweatsuits?
No, these were Run Disney regular announcers. I blank on the name. I just know DJ Elliott because, hey, man, he's the one playing the music, keeping me awake.
Right.
But here's where my race went different. It started to rain.
Ooh. During the race or while you were waiting?
Nope. Race had not started yet. We had one of the announcers come on and say, we are delaying the race. We will come back at 6 o'clock. Because remember, the race was supposed to start at 5:30. They come back on a little after 6. Said they have to evacuate the area due to lightning. And keep in mind, Disney is prepared for rain. But when it's lightning, it's a whole different story. You've got safety to keep in mind.
And you have how many people in the corrals? Estimate how many people are in the parking lot.
Oh, thousands.
Okay,
if not tens of thousands.
Okay.
So, I mean, you've got to evacuate these people. And so basically what they had people do, because the corrals are sectioned off by metal partitions, which, of course, is not a safe thing to be around when there's lightning.
You think?
Yeah. So they ask you to either go back to your car, and they will email, check the website, check Facebook for updates. They have buses for you to sit in, or they were also taking people up to the entrance of Epcot. And to my understanding, they were taking them around Inventions, since that is essentially an empty area right now.
Oh, that's true. And it is pretty close to the entrance. It's like right there. So why not?
Yeah.
So how long did you have to wait?
2 hours.
Wow.
Now, after 2 hours, did they just, okay, we're starting and then shoot off?
They're starting and shoot off. So about 7:20, 7:30, I'm crossing that start line to go. And instead of doing
what
the corrals, 7:20, 7:30. So like I said, we're talking about a 2 hour delay.
Yeah. What time does Epcot open? At 9?
Epcot open at 9. World Showcase open at 11.
Okay.
They adjusted the race. So it wasn't a true 5K, but that's because of safety reasons and time constraints. The only people that went ahead of everybody else was, they called the push start. These are the people in wheelchairs. These are the disability people that also still want to do the races, which personally, I think it's awesome that they have that ability to do those races. And you go instead of doing separate corrals like they normally do, where there's like a couple minute delay so you don't have this huge rush of people walking through. Everybody just go.
Is the photo opportunities and the little things that you run past, and how was that? And did the rain impact any of that stuff?
It did. So you're exactly right. If you've never done a Run Disney race, one thing besides running through the parks that is awesome about a Run Disney race is there's characters and there's photo ops throughout the course. They are themed to the race. So, of course, this was Star Wars themed.
Right. Nice.
So there was only one place to stop during the race to do any photo op. And that was, it was a chair. I want to say it was from one of the Death Star that you could sit in and kind of feel like you were there. I didn't get a good look at it because there were so many people. And honestly, it was still raining. So the lightning had gone, but it was still raining, so I wasn't stopping.
Right.
But towards the end of the race, it started to clear up a little bit. And they had some of the characters out, but it was such all the characters are kind of in the same area. So it was so crowded that I just kept going. But I saw Rey, I saw, R2-D2, I saw, stormtroopers. And I want to say some of the stormtroopers were even from the, 501 that is a very,
that's cool.
You know, big stormtrooper group that everybody knows about in the Star Wars world.
Yeah.
But yeah, it constantly rained the entire time. I actually try to keep everybody up to date on Instagram stories on our Instagram page. It was a good race. It was an interesting race. It would have been better, of course, if it wasn't raining, but hey,
sure.
It's Florida. If you don't plan for rain, then you went to the wrong state.
Did you have rain gear, Morgan?
No, because even though...
I thought we went through this on the 4th of July.
We did, but here's the thing. It's different for a race, because you don't sure. want to be bogged down by a bunch of things.
Sweating underneath the rain gear, I get it.
Exactly. So I'll tell you, I had... my sneakers, two pairs of socks. I had, you know, my workout gear. I don't do the costumes because the costumes are, I personally, for me, are a little constricting. I think it's awesome the people that do costumes when they run, and some of those costumes are amazing. I personally don't do them. So I had my workout gear. I had an armband that I had my phone in. I had my, you know, my license and other important cards that I needed. I had my key fob for my car. I had headphones. That was it. That is all that was on my person.
Oh, well, I tell you what, the costume for the day would have been Mary Poppins and the umbrella, I think. Would have totally got away
that's
with that
right.
one.
Yeah, that's a tough for a Star Wars event, but you're right.
Now, I tell you what, before we move on, what kind of swag did you get afterwards? You got a medal or what happened? What'd you get?
I got an amazing medal.
Do they hand that to you when you cross the finish line, or do you go? How's that work?
So when you go through, you cross the finish line, and also one thing you got to keep in mind: there's actually photo pass people throughout the entire race, including the finish line. So you cross that finish line, which was a little slippery because of the rain. So I didn't run it. You kind of go around a couple corners. They hand you your medal. You get a snack box, which has a banana, has some chips, has right. maybe like a protein bar. There's some photo pass opportunities to take a picture with your medal. If you brought stuff in, there's a bag check. And then you go home.
Or to the park.
Or to the park. I was very, very soggy, so I didn't go to the park. I went home and dried off, or went back to my hotel room and dried off.
Oh, sure.
Took a warm shower.
Oh, no, you have to recover a little bit. Getting up that early, oh my gosh, that's horrible.
Yeah. And especially waiting around, I think that was what was worse.
Yeah.
It's just waiting around.
And you're standing waiting around. There's no place to sit, right?
Yeah, I mean, I did walk back to my car because it was...
Sure.
During the delay, it was one of those torrential downpours where you couldn't look up and see you... had to find shelter.
So there's an advantage of being off site and having your car there versus busing over from a resort.
Exactly. And I have stayed on property and done a Run Disney race. I personally will still drive. They really do promote you to use their transportation.
Sure.
And honestly, if they did a race that say started in Magic Kingdom, where I was staying at the Contemporary or one of those Magic Kingdom resorts, I would totally take advantage of the transportation. But Epcot parking lot, it's not that convenient to like walk from your resort if you really had to of the Epcot resorts.
Epcot's ridiculous bus stop wise. I mean, that's pretty far a walk. So I drive there all the time. That's a no-brainer. Well, I'll tell you what was the big Easter tradition you saw this week?
Oh, yeah. So, if you've ever been to Walt Disney World during Easter time, one thing that I highly, highly, highly recommend doing is taking a stop over at the Grand Floridian and checking out the chocolate Easter eggs. All over the lobby, they have hand-decorated, like oversized chocolate Easter eggs, all different themes by the amazing culinary teams all over Disney World property. And it's just amazing to see the detail, see the work that went in. And these have all kinds of themes. You've got your Disney movies. You've got just beautifully intricate designs. You've got works of art that have been replicated onto the eggs. You name it, it's got some kind of theme on these eggs. And like I said, if you're there during Easter, it's the must-see.
This is really expanded beyond just the Grand Floridian. Last year, I was able to see some eggs over at the Yacht Club and in the Contemporary. And I actually talked to one of the chefs who was setting things up. And it's become quite the competition internally for their pastry chefs to come up with a great design and some artwork. And it really is. It's awesome. And there's a photo report from last year. And Morgan's going to be doing one for this year. And that's perfect.
Right.
Something to do if you're there for the holidays.
All over on the blog. Now, I tell you what, I love when they do these competition things. I think Halloween, they do something similar with pumpkins and artwork and things like that between the different resorts and employees. This is always a good thing, especially if you're doing those resort tours that we talk about every so often. To luck out and have one of these opportunities is really, really fun.
It is. And you also got the egg extravaganza over at Epcot during Flower and Garden. That's a great thing to do at Easter, but I digress like I always do.
And actually, me and my friend did it. Now, we did not pay the $6.99 for the map. We found we took a picture of the map and we went on search and we found all the eggs while we were at Epcot last week. So that was fun. We didn't really need the prize. We just wanted the challenge.
That's a great idea and something you can do with no cost. I love it.
And of course, Flower and Garden was going on. So you also still had Spike's scavenger hunt. So during Easter, it's actually a really awesome time to go to Epcot. You've got two scavenger hunts, Flower and Garden and the Extravaganza. And then if you're over by Magic Kingdom, hop on the monorail, go to the Grand Floridian, check out the eggs there. And also now, check out the eggs of the Yacht and Beach Club.
Sweet.
Nice. Sounds like a great opportunity. Okay, guys. Well, I tell you what, that is getting me just a little bit hungry. And I think it's time for our final matchups in the Disney Dining Madness.
Disney Dining Madness. We're here. We're at the end. We've been doing this for a few weeks now, more than a few weeks. We started with 64 sit-down restaurants in Walt Disney World's Dining Madness. Then we threw a surprise out there and came up with Character Dining Madness because we wanted to kind of separate those two things. And we've narrowed it down to two in each of these categories. And we have a championship game to cover tonight to crown where is the best dining location at Walt Disney World according to the Disney Nerds podcast listeners and hosts. And I think we start with Dining Madness, the final round. Le Cellier in Epcot's World Showcase Canada and the California Grill in the Contemporary Hotel on the top floor overlooking Magic Kingdom. And just start with, you can't go wrong with either one of these.
Oh, of course not.
So no, I think these are two amazing mashups.
Absolutely, starting with this one and the others, and there's a whole bunch in here, and you know, we started this thing, and I'll repeat what we said before, and I know you have as well, Ed. This was all about maybe getting you to try something you hadn't tried before. We talked about a lot of these, 64 of these different dining locations and resorts and theme parks at Disney Springs, and maybe you try something you hadn't tried before, and interestingly enough, some have opened since we started this that we've blogged about, which may have changed the results. I don't know, but with us having gotten to them, maybe not. But it's just interesting to see how quickly things change.
J-Lo. Yeah, very true. So I tell you what, let's get to the voting on this one because I need to know what is the best sit-down restaurant in Walt Disney World.
Le Cellier versus the California Grill. Like we have before, we have votes from our podcast hosts and then a vote from our online listeners, and also the Tuesday Night Live show. So where should we start here? Ed, should I start with you?
I think that's a great idea because this is going to be very, very easy for me. I am going to be picking Le Cellier. I've been taking this restaurant the entire way through this tournament. I have had nothing but good things to say about Le Cellier. And even saying that, though, I am definitely going to be checking out the California Grill. That is on my list of must-dos now.
You know, the interesting thing about Le Cellier is that it was a number 11 seed in our tournament, coming from touringplants.com, which was really interesting. And, of course, California Grill is a number one seed. But interesting to see that. So we got Ed's vote for Le Cellier. Morgan, let's go to you.
I went Le Cellier as well. Because, hey, it's steak.
Morgan's got Le Cellier, too.
Steak in the basement.
Exactly. Steak in the cellar.
Now, that just sounds like you're just trying to sneak and eat some steak behind somebody's back. Steak in the basement. Come on, guys.
Sorry, I got to bring the website up. Give me 1 minute.
Yep.
All right, next I am going to... Oh, I'm not going to go there. I'm going to go next. Le Cellier, California Grill, love them both. Love the location of Le Cellier, although I've been quoted before saying there's a better steak just around the corner at the Yachtsman, but I won't go there. But I am going to put the California Grill because that's where I want to head next. I just love that view, watching the fireworks. So my vote is California Grill.
Okay.
So we have 3 votes in, and I think each of us have another vote to go with. So, Ed, do you have Jimmy's vote?
I do indeed. And Jimmy's so sorry not to be here to vote tonight. He actually goes with Le Cellier also.
Wow. Jimmy's got Le Cellier.
Uh-oh.
So that's 3-2. Morgan, I think you have Lisa's vote.
I do. I have Lisa's vote as well as the live show's vote. So, Lisa, now do we really have to ask Lisa's vote?
No, we don't.
But just for record purposes only, we're keeping this official. She went California Grill.
Yeah, that does not surprise me whatsoever. which is fine. I picked it as well. So do we have the live show votes there too? One of you two have those, right?
I have the live show votes. The live show. I think Lisa might have influenced them because they went California Grill.
Live show is California Grill, which means Le Cellier, California Grill, 3-3. The champion is going to come down to the DisneyNerdsPodcast.com voters and what was voted online, which, by the way, this particular bracket was open for 2 weeks worth of voting. So we have more votes for this one than we've had anything through the entire competition.
Well, it's an important vote. Wow.
It's an important case with 58%. Versus 42, online voters have chosen Le Cellier as the winner of the Disney Nerds Podcast Dining Madness 2019 Sit Down Championship.
There you go.
Woohoo!
Totally expected it. Totally, and that number 11 team, no problem.
I sort of expected it too because Le Cellier for a long time has had the line. You had a call way ahead. Although I will say, even as recently as my last trip, Le Cellier for lunch has had quite the availability, and it's not a bad place to hit for lunch, even though we're talking dinner.
Oh, sure. Oh, no doubt. I remember using Le Cellier as the restaurant for when we did the Candlelight Processional. So we had the special seating for that. And it was great because that was during our we had the free dining at the same time, so it all worked
out. Yeah, it doesn't get better than that.
Yep, exactly.
Free dining with a Candlelight package at Le Cellier? Sign me up.
Oh, that was just perk on top of perk on top of perk right there.
No doubt.
Exactly.
Okay, guys, well, I'll tell you what. Let's move on with the character final matchup because I want to know who's going to be signing my autograph book.
And that's exactly what this comes down to some extent. Is it Stitch or is it Winnie the Pooh? We have the number 5-seeded Ohana, which is over at the Polynesian Resort. And we have the Crystal Palace inside of the Magic Kingdom right there on Main Street with Winnie the Pooh and friends. And I think since our online voters decided the last round, we're going to let them go first this time. Does that sound fair?
Fair enough.
That sounds fair to me.
Absolutely. So online, 57% went with Ohana.
So close either way, though. Wow.
It is. These are close. And that's good because it's good any way you look at it.
Yeah.
All right. With that, we'll do the live show next.
Well, the live show also went Ohana.
Live show Ohana. There you go. How about Jimmy, Ed?
Jimmy and his entire family go with Ohana.
Yeah. Why?
They only count as one vote, though.
That is true. That is true, but still, they did a lot of weight behind that.
Which is fine.
Yep.
I will go next, if that's okay. Here's the way I'm looking at this one. I've done Crystal Palace. It's been quite a long time, so I wouldn't say it's in recent memory. Ohana, I want to get to, but Crystal Palace gets me inside the Magic Kingdom before it opens, if I so choose. It's right there in the middle of everything. You can sit down and watch the hubbub and the bustle of what's happening. As far as characters, neither one of these characters influenced me to go one direction or the other. I would have gone to Chef Mickey's all along, to be honest, because of characters. But here, I'm going to go Crystal Palace. So, 3 votes, Ohana. 1 for Crystal Palace. And Ed, I think we'll go with you next.
Okay, I am actually going to be going with Ohana. Make that one a quick one and right to the point. I thought that was an incredible breakfast. I think the novelty of the breakfast, of what was served, and the characters were pretty cool too. Seeing Mickey out of his normal outfit into the Hawaiian shirt and such like that. And Stitch is cool.
Morgan, how about you?
This was a tough one for me. I've done Crystal Palace. I have not done Ohana. I kind of was leaning the same way, just like you, Sam. You've got the Crystal Palace with the history and everything like that. I also have to have read books in the past as far as the influence of that building, which is really cool. But characters came down for me. I love Stitch, so I had to go Ohana.
Morgan's got Ohana, which is going to – it actually put it with the win. I think the live viewers – no, we did the live viewers. We do not have Lisa's vote.
Correct.
Well, Lisa went Ohana as well, so –
Which Ohana. Means I am the only one to not pick Ohana, which I think happened in a previous round, by the way. Yep. So Ohana is the best character dining at Walt Disney World, according to the Disney Nerds podcast, our listeners, our live show viewers. Looks like I need to go to Ohana since I'm the only one that didn't vote for it.
That sounds like a trip. We're going to have to plan that one out.
I feel like there should be a Disney Nerds reservation made in the future for all of us to go to Ohana.
I, you know what? I would go to all 4 of these restaurants in the next trip. We'll do La Salia one day, then go Crystal Palace the next, then California Grill, then Ohana.
I'm going to go
on a limb. 4 days of dining.
And say
sounds
we're
good.
Do...
We're using Jimmy's credit card on that, right?
Okay, guys. So, what do you think? Did we get one of your favorite restaurants as the top restaurants in Walt Disney World in our Madness Challenge? If not, or if we did, either way, we want to hear from you. Jimmy, tell everybody how to get in touch with the show.
You can email us at questions at thedisneynerdspodcast.com and email us individually at ed@thedisneynerdspodcast.com, jimmy@thedisneynerdspodcast.com, etc. You can send us a message on Facebook to the page, The Disney Nerds Podcast. Join our group, Disney Nerds, Instagram at The Disney Nerds Podcast, and Twitter at The Disney Nerds. Make sure to check out the website, www.thedisneynerdspodcast.com. And watch the live stream every Tuesday night at 9 o'clock Walt Disney World time.
Okay, guys. So that's it for show number 284 of the Disney Nerds podcast. We had some more updates from the park. We got to experience the Star Wars 5K with Morgan. And we finished up our Disney Dining Challenge for 2019.
Ed, we talk about so much stuff. Ed, I don't know how you do it. You are a master at bringing the show in at about an hour when I could talk for 3 hours about one of the topics we talked about.
Oh, it
I don't
is
know
a
how
challenge.
You do it, dude.
It is a tough one.
Yeah, I second that. We could have definitely taken many episodes to talk about what we just covered in this one episode today.
And well, I think that we will in the future because we got to talk about the Fox acquisition. We got to talk about, you know, Fox. The Simpsons are now a Disney property, for crying out loud. See, oh, by the way, I got another big topic. Ed, which is in Walt Disney World post Fox acquisition, there are only 2 attractions that are not themed by a property that Disney owns in all of Walt Disney World. And both of them are at the end of Sunset Boulevard. We can talk about that later. Because Disney just bought Avatar when they bought 20th Century Fox. Kind of cool.
I know. It's kind of mind-boggling as far as the different implications of everything that's been going on the last couple weeks. I can't wait till we kind of figure it all out. And you know what? That's the bonus of having our own podcast, because we can talk about it anytime we want. And we will. Okay, guys. So that's it. And we will talk to you next week. Bye-bye.
Have a magical night. Hakuna Matata.
Kongaloosh!
If you would like to join our jamboree, there's a simple rule that's compulsory.